alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, everybody.
Wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi.
Okay, as you all know, I'm a social worker at the Islamic Careline. Strangely enough, I came to the Careline many years ago as a third year social work student. And little did I realize that I was going to stay for a very, very long time. I don't have any regrets about where I've been all these years. Lots of people have asked me over the years, why don't you move on? Why don't you try something different? Why don't you do something different? But I think, you know, when you start at a place like the Islamic Careline, or when you start servicing our community, it feels almost like moving away for professional reasons is an abandonment of the work that we do. So I've been now at the Islamic Airline for 18 years, and it's been an interesting 18 years. We've seen a lot of change, a lot of growth, a lot of heartbreak, but also a lot of positive as well. And I think when Kari Moosa asked me to speak about the challenges, I thought, okay, I don't think I'm going to speak about the challenges. I will include that, but I'm going to focus on both positive and negative dynamics. Okay, so I'm going to leave behind some pamphlets of the Islamic Careline for those of you who don't know too much about it. But essentially, the Islamic Careline is a psychosocial service. Okay, we focus on addressing the emotional and even sometimes psychological needs of our community. But obviously, with that comes welfare stuff, it comes distress of all natures. We do a little bit of poverty alleviation, but it's not our focus. And giving you a little bit of history, the Islamic Airline started in 1992 in a very small capacity. And I think my director was here, she'd speak about the humble beginnings. Literally in one office with one phone. Alhamdulillah, the Jamiat took us on as their project. I'm not sure at that time if anyone thought that it would grow to this extent, but alhamdulillah, with the mercy of Allah and the guidance of Allah, I think we managed to continue and strive. But I think about a big part of the sustainability of the Careline has been through the volunteers. Their value cannot be underestimated. And for me, the Islamic Careline is one of the biggest community development projects I know. And when you look at community development, it talks about addressing community needs. But I think at that time, to take women who wanted to contribute to society and kind of capacitating them, educating them, and then in the process, them servicing the community, I think has added a great deal of value, not only to the organization, but also to the lives of the volunteers themselves. And I'm going to speak a little bit about that as well. Okay, so if you look at the dynamic of the Islamic Airline, we have staff members and we have volunteers. But interestingly enough, the staff members, most of them started as volunteers. At a time when the Careline was not a registered NPO, relying solely on the assistance of volunteers. And then as we grew and registered with the Department of Social Development, employed staff members, became more structured, more formal, and with that came growth. But I think the value that we got as volunteers first fed into the commitment of some of the volunteers, some of the staff members. And I think you can see the change. When people start as staff members compared to those who start as volunteers, you can see a big difference between the two, because it's not just a salary, it's not just a form of livelihood. It's a commitment to something that you truly believe in. Okay, so I think that leads then into my next point, and that's about intention. We all have the intention to help. But I think now and again, we need to check that. We always need to check why we're doing that. It's not necessarily because we need to be patted on our backs or we need acknowledgement. But that having been said, like Brother Idris said, Uncle Idris said, that it's nice to hear a good word. it feeds into our motivation. And I think that's what we try to do always. We have to remember the issue of responsibility, commitment. I know as volunteers, we rely a great deal on our volunteers, and they committed to a specific time. Yes, we, you know, as staff members, we say you kind of paid for your time. As volunteers, it's your time. But at the same time, you know, if we're seeing clients, you have to have a sense of commitment. We rely on you, and without the commitment of the volunteers, we can't provide a professional service. We can't even provide an effective or an efficient service. And so that's one of the most important things. Also, as volunteers, you know, we need to check what our need is. We all have a need. What is that need? To give back, to do. But that need is also to do something within us. It feeds into our purpose. It feeds into our sense of morality. None of us do something for nothing. We're doing it because we also benefit from it. And inshallah, we'll benefit in this world and in the year after for the work that we do on for our fellow human beings. Expectations. What would you expect being a volunteer? And it doesn't have to necessarily be material expectations. It can be just in terms of your function, your role. What is it that you want to do when you volunteer? Which is the place that you volunteer? You know, whenever I do counseling training, or especially when I do the screening, I'll ask people, okay, so why do you want to do counseling? When you say you want to give back to the community, you can give back in so many ways. But why do you choose the specific work that you've chosen to do? Why is that special to your heart? And again, you know, we spoke about wanting, when we talk about changing, we talk about external change, our environment and the people around us and the ummah, and then we talk about our personal change. And these are questions we need to ask. Is that when we change, do we change, and for who do we change? Do we change for ourselves? Will you change for the others or for the community? But where does that come from? And why is it that we want to grow and improve? Okay. And that then feeds me into not just personal growth, but it's also about, when we talk about professional growth, but also empowerment, reward. And why I talk about empowerment is because I remember when in the early days of the Careline, people were sensitive to the word, to the phrase women empowerment, because it was associated with liberalism and feminism. But you know, empowerment for me is just accessing the power within you. And that's all it is. And even when we volunteer, it's easy to give money. If we have money, we can give it and have someone else distribute it. But what's valuable, more valuable than that, is the time that you take out of your day to give to those who are less fortunate than yourselves. Okay? With being part of any organization, and this is also an Islamic value, accountability. We all accountable for the actions that we undertake, even as volunteers, even as people who want to serve the community. I think for me, one of the, you know, we see, and in all of you, I'm sure, sitting here can relate, we see a lot of heartbreak, we see a lot of distress, we see a lot of pain. And sometimes it can even affect us personally. And that's something, again, we need to be conscious of. Do we become desensitized? Does it make us emotional? Does it make us better people? Does it make us more grateful? But I think, again, a value is realizing that we can be part of the positive. We can be part of the positive change. We can be part of the solutions. And that is the most empowering for me, is that we know what's going on around us. We can see what's going on around us. It's not all pleasant, unfortunately. But I think making the difference, and you know, it's not about changing the world. None of us can change the world. None of us can rescue everybody. None of us can save everybody. But I think it comes back to that simple intention of making the small little differences and doing what we can. And if everybody does the little things, then we can, inshallah, make a big difference. I think what has happened over the years is that we become desensitized. But aside from that, I think our values get tested. We see so many things around us in the field that we work in. We see children abandoning their parents. We see children abusing their parents. We see spouses abusing one another. We see our families breaking down. And those are distressing things. Those are painful things. And I think every day we have to do introspection. To what extent do we say it's part of life? It's becoming a norm. Substance abuse is okay. Infidelity is becoming acceptable. Gambling is becoming acceptable. So those are value challenges that we face on a daily basis, right? Where do we draw the line? Where do we say as Muslims, this is where it stops? This is what we're going to do, okay? In terms of the community at large, I think over the years, as far as counseling is concerned, we've had mixed responses. Initially, people were not very open to counseling. 1992 was before apartheid was abolished. Things opened up in the two years thereafter. But I think counseling was still something that people, still today you get people who are not so open to counseling, but the shift has taken place. There was a time when the bulk of our services were rendered to women. We've become more women-focused, to more family-focused. Men have appreciated the value of counseling and wanting to assist females in making the changes in their families. We're seeing more children, but then that's not necessarily a positive for me, because the more children we see, the more we know that they are being affected by what's going on at home. And when we talk about the fact that we want to help people internationally, but yet our own families are struggling, and in ways that are not, that we have to take responsibility for, okay? If you look at Islam has been in the limelight for a good few years now, and not necessarily for positive reasons, but it's created a whole lot of awareness around Islam. And I think in the field that we're in, especially when we do counseling and we look at the values, how has our values changed over time as Muslims? And I'll be honest with you, sometimes when you listen to some of the clients, you really wonder if it's a Muslim client. Because the kind of things that's happening out there doesn't make you very proud, okay? But I think still, we can still try, we can still challenge people, we can still hope that the fact that people are coming for counseling means that there's openness to change and wanting to improve and become better people. So again, like I say, you know, it's good to be part of the positive process. In terms of the clients that we get, the nature of cases are becoming more and more complex. Training is needed, and training also, I think, is something that we give to our counselors. It's important. It feeds into their capacity. It feeds into their empowerment. It helps them to do the work that they do more effectively and more efficiently. But even so, it's a little thank you that we give them. Maybe some of them don't always see it. But I think it's something that we feed into for themselves in their own growth. And I think that for me is important, because we're all in the process of growing and changing. Okay. So going back to the community, I think the needs are becoming very complex. The demands are becoming great. And I think that we always need to look at what it is that the community needs on a regular basis, and that always changes. And I think our religious leaders, our imams, our mulanas, our alims are aware of that, and they're also trying to address these things in the best ways that they can, knowing full well that we need to be changing our approaches in how we deal with those complex dynamics of society today. One of the challenges that we do face, although, like I said, people are becoming more open to the concept of counseling, commitment and responsibility. Although lots of people come forward when they need help, there are a lot of people who refuse to acknowledge that they need help. And also when you look at community-based organizations, they take for granted. So the commitment to the process is not always there. Sometimes you see it, sometimes you don't. So there's, like I said, it's mixed. There's both positive and negative responses. With the changing dynamics in the community as well, we've had to look at a variety of services, whether it be trauma, whether it be play therapy for children, whether it be exploring all different kinds of interventions that are available for substance abuse. So it's an ongoing reflection of services. It's an ongoing need to change. But ideally, what I'm saying is that we need to go with the change. We need to accommodate the community's needs. We need to always evaluate our actions and check that it's in keeping, and we need to adapt with those things as we move on. Okay, I'm not so sure how I'm doing with time, but I've reached almost the end of my presentation. But I do want to leave you with a few questions. Like I mentioned before, why have you chosen this particular work? Why not anywhere else? Why not any other organization? Okay, that's something that you need to think about. What's fulfilling about it? Okay, what do you get out of it? What's meaningful for you? What's meaningful for you? What meaning does it give to you? At the same time, what's challenging for you? What do you struggle with working as a volunteer? What are your expectations as a volunteer? Where do you want to see your work? What are your goals as a volunteer? What do you want to see happening as a result of your contribution? I think what's important then is a lot of introspection. And again, as Muslims, we're supposed to take stock of our lives on a daily basis. And I think that's something that we, even as volunteers, need to do regularly. And what do we give? It's not like we said earlier, it's not just about what you're getting. But at the same time, we're all motivated by what feeds us. Okay, so bear in mind what that does for you. I think the Islamic Careline, one of our mottos is that we strive for excellence. But we all know that we're not perfect. We can only try to embed ourselves. And indeed, Allah responds to the call of His servant as long as His servant is in the service of His fellow human beings. And I think if we keep in mind that always in whatever we do, then inshallah, we will always have His guidance and we'll always have His mercy. Jazakallah. Assalamu alaikum.